thank you for inviting me to this panel. And indeed, I would like to begin with an insight into a report, actually two reports that we recently released. One is, and the other, concerned with scenarios on the future. So they both relate very much to the question of illiberalism. And while explaining the reports, explaining the context behind them, of why even and how the exercise went on, I will touch upon the questions of trends that are taking into consideration when mapping out possible futures. Then I'll try to have a take on the question of illiberalism itself. What is it? And I'll go into the explanation of the two specific scenarios, each of them taken from one and the other report from the presentation, and just throw it at you to hopefully have a debate. This is not a scientific project. This is not a research project. It's something between, what you do as an analyst, a political analyst, but it's far from fortune teller. The scenarios that I will be mapping out are worked through with a group of participants mostly from Central Europe, that were trying to organize otherwise very chaotic debate about what may happen. What are the course of events in the political directions that Central Europe is facing? So one of the reports that just been released a couple of weeks ago touches upon the European parliamentary futures. It outlines four possible scenarios, political directions. Rather than presenting the seat distribution, which is still a big question, but we have the projections from various sources, it dwells on the political narratives and the directions. What will be the effects of different potential coalitions or lack of certain coalitions in the European Parliament for the main directions, for the main political directions there? And the first report has these four titles, Home of Eurosceptics, Illiberal Fade-Out, that I'll dwell upon later on, Grand Rule of Law, Gang of Nations, all dependent on different seat distribution and different coalition making. The website tells where you can download it, and there is a substantial portion of research also gathered on digital disinformation, which is high. Just to refer to what Václav mentioned already on disinformation, digital disinformation, I think in the very same report or a similar report from Reuters, Oxford Internet Institute, we have a data that says that 0.1% of social media accounts on Twitter produce 10% of political content online. So just to illustrate you how important for political election that also is. And the second report I'm referring to is a bit earlier one, but much more looking much more further into the next 7 years or so. It's a report that we released at the end of last year, projecting one could say geopolitical futures or scenarios for the region of Central Europe. Central Europe taken as the 4v4 countries. And there you go. And I won't go into detail because we'll go directly to the question of the panel. The five scenarios: the triumph of illiberalism. This is the point. This is the one that I'm going to touch upon. Then the Central European fracture, shotgun wedding, a beautiful American title. See into it if you're interested. Central European spring 2.0 and security vacuum. All of them explained in the report. But the trends that both reports and both of these sets of scenarios start the journey from, or where we begin the recognition of these possible futures, are certain elements of that I think are important also before we go into later debate. there are notions that are today global notions of trends that have that are specifically pronounced in Central Europe, and this to this I would like to touch. I would like to touch them because they will have a reference. They are in strong relationship or in strong reference to the question of populism, liberalism, and the changes or challenges to democracy. To democracy, there is overall end of certainty about the liberal international order. The academic discourse on that, as well as a political discourse, is huge, and it's penetrating simply the public discourse overall. We're having a debate about the end of institutional world order as we know it, a liberal one, and that has consequences. There is a resurgence of nationalism, and the resurgence of nationalism that already has been mentioned across the world is especially pronounced again in Europe, where it directly challenges the European project. So there is the notion that, you know, somehow nations are better than transnational, national projects are better than transnational. And again, that's a big global trend, where in Central Europe specifically and ahead of European parliamentary elections, this will be very important. There are challenges, and this is by no means should not be forgotten, that are addressed perhaps just by one side of the political spectrum specifically so far, But they are seen and observed by all of the spectrum of political debate, which is the changes in the economic model, robotization, the changes of the social structure, the end of the middle class, the questions of who is in the middle and what is the future of labor and the possibility of upgrading your social position. These are all in the question, along, of course, with the demographic decline. I mean, you look at the, especially again, Eastern Europe, and you see that 9 countries of Eastern Europe are in the global forefront of the demographic decline. I mean, these countries are depopulating the fastest in the world. And there are the questions about the future of EU, institutionally, future of NATO, welcome, you know, Mr. Trump, the message, but there are other voices that question or put NATO project into crisis, and these are all trends that project on the dilemmas and questions related to illiberalism. And there is, of course, the return of geopolitics, a strange term that we can. It's a separate debate whether it makes sense to use it or not. Specifically, our Russian colleagues are very happy to use it, not only in academic discourse, but rather in practice, and then take land grabs by military force and establish new barriers against the, again, liberal world order. Let's leave the upcoming elements. There is a set of uncertainties also that I just mentioned here that also project on the future of illiberalism. Now, a quick take on illiberalism itself. We are always in need of definitions. I'm not sure we have a good definition of illiberalism, but my definition of illiberalism will be a simple dysfunction. It's a cover. It's a cover up to the dysfunctionalities of democratic process. Someone cannot honestly win elections, so he cheats. And then tells, well, it's illiberal, you know, it's not liberal, it's illiberal. We have to put some ideology hat on that. That was the story of 2014, Mr. Surkov's take on the elections in Russia, where he said, somehow these elections in Russia were sort of democratic, but instead of saying sort of democratic, he said illiberal. This was illiberal democracy in the making. The illiberalism itself, you know, makes a big word and already constitutes a large part of the discourse about, you know, as an ideology. But I wouldn't like to treat it as an ideology. I would rather propose that we, or any kind of a positive project where it proposes to do something, it is rather the absence of norms and the absence of regulations otherwise in place and otherwise agreed upon. And because of deficiency of democracy, it is something minor, something inferior to democracy. That's why it's illiberal. And especially it's somehow observed in the post-communist countries where some of the countries displayed that, well, they could not deliver or they could not protect against such a dysfunction. Now into the two scenarios, and there I'll conclude. In the scenario coming from Central European future, 7 years projection, one of the scenarios that we are proposing to consider as feasible, not again, this is not a crystal ball, this is feasible, this is something that helps you think through the consequences of certain trends as I described them, is that not only in Central Europe but across many European countries, illiberal forces will be gaining. You have AfD, you have Salvini, perhaps I should start with Salvini because AfD somehow is reaching the glass ceiling of in Germany. But there is Mr. Salvini, there is Vox in Spain, there is Le Pen, we'll see the results in France. And imagine that these forces in subsequent elections, this is not only European elections this year, this is, I mean, European Union parliamentary elections, which already would count like 28 in all countries because, well, UK will be voting. But it's more like 50. This is more, and by the way, this will have a tremendous result also on the scene, and well, we can touch upon this later. This is more like 50 elections, electoral process in Europe, only this year. Local elections, presidential elections, parliamentary elections, all across different countries. In all of these elections, because of the fragility of the system, because of these trends, including the disinformation, we don't know how much of an effect disinformation has on electoral results, but we assume there is one, if not important one, then significant. You take the European project, you take it away from the democratic process, the democratic substance, and you hollow it out. If my definition, if you agree with the functional definition of illiberalism, the EU democratic process becomes more of a facade overall in the process, and slowly but surely stops taking into account the possibility of, you know, value discussion about values, norms, what is right, and takes all the dysfunctionalities of democracy as a new norm. At the end of this, we have a sort of a Europe of nation states, a Europe that withdraws from the ambition to integrate its policies, to coordinate its policies, and you have like these leadership-driven circles that somehow overlap with each other, which you know, in the illustration here may touch upon this idea that we still have something in common in Europe, but the zones of commonalities are shrinking. I will only mention, before going to this one, that this is unstable scenario. Even though we put a 7 years long perspective, this is not a scenario that can last very long. It will, and it evolves into something else that I stop here, what it could be, but definitely this is not a future of European integration. And then the other scenario, quite contrary to the first one that I presented, taken from the other report, from the newest report, and also very kind of short, shorter perspective, is the illiberal fade out. Now, because what I said about Brexit and Brexit, I mean Britain most likely voting, I know nothing is sure in Brexit, but imagining that Britain will vote, and the Labour will have more votes than Tories if they are voting. Also in the European Parliament, that illiberal fade-out may actually turn into grand rule of law. Again, another scenario in the same report. because of other factors. But this scenario assumes that EPP is the a strong and goes out from the election as the strongest, not as much damage as Social Democrats. This is the British question, because Social Democrats without Labour will lose significant portion of the votes, and that allows EPP to slowly sideline Viktor Orban and Fidesz from the mainstream and to prey on his agenda. Fidesz expelled eventually in this scenario from EPP gives EPP an opportunity, as we could have seen in many cases, of the center-right party to position itself a little bit on the agenda that has been the agenda of a more radical partner before. Along with the other along with the parties of the groupings like ECR, European Conservative Reformists, which actually aspire to be more important and to go into a coalition, potential coalition with EPP, this allows to have some votes and allows to have some acceptance from the mainstream of European politics towards the radicals or towards those who are considered illiberals, but at the same time it takes away the fuel and the potential, the disruption potential and the initiative from the parties that drive the illiberal message in Europe. And in a way, that is one of the ways or one of the scenarios in which the illiberalism of sorts might end, because whatever we can say of the ÖVP of Sebastian Kurz, it did not become illiberal. It took away the agenda, and it constantly takes away the agenda of what we would say the of the radical partner in the government away from them, and weakens their position vis-à-vis the constituency, and consolidates still a mainstream, more right than center, but still center-right political grouping. And that would be the illiberal fade-out. I won't go into the tipping points. So the scenarios that I just presented, again, they're not predictions. This is not forecasting. This is just thinking through the possibilities, and it's an invitation to a discussion, to structuring the discussion that we're having anyway. Thank you very much for attending.